It's game number 6 of the National League Championship Series. Tonight on FS1, it's the Los Angeles Dodgers, the Chicago Cubs. The Chicago up 3-2. Welcome inside the broadcast booth, everybody. It's getting loud back there right now. I'm Joe Buck, the Hall of Famer. John Smoltz is coming right up. All right, we feel the same way. We can't wait to get the first pitch. But even if we talk really fast up here, first pitch is coming when first pitch is coming. You walk around downtown Chicago today, and everybody's talking about history. Is tonight going to be history? You know who doesn't care about history tonight? Better said, you know who doesn't want to be a part of history tonight? The great Clayton Kershaw. He gets the ball for the Dodgers, a guy who got the ball in situations like this many times for the Braves is John Smoltz. And I can't wait for first pitch, and I know you feel the same way.
Well, it's been 7 years since I've thrown a pitch in a playoff scenario, and I can't wait. This is the game I wanted to see. It doesn't disappoint us in game two with a 1-0 game. I don't think it'll disappoint us again. This is a classic matchup against two of the best. And look at the ERAs combined. Only one other matchup had a better ERA combined, and that's Gibson and McLain. I don't think you could have a better scenario, a better scene, and a crowd on the edge of their seats.
Yeah, it's going to be a lot of fun. So let's talk specifics now, and let's talk about Clayton Kershaw. He's been so good. He was so good in game two. How do the Cubs go after the big left-hander?
Well, I think they got to change their approach. They got to be aggressive. And look, if Clayton Kershaw is working the corners with his fastball in and away like he did in game two, it's going to be a challenge. He commands the fastball. It's straight, but it's firm. He throws that slider off of it as well. But this is what the Cubs are hoping they don't see. They got to take advantage of mistakes. They must be aggressive. And let's not forget, this is a different lineup than the lineup he faced and a much more hot lineup.
Yeah, no doubt about that. Okay, so now on the other side, you have the less tested right-hander in Kyle Hendricks, but a guy who had the best ERA in baseball this year. How do the Dodgers go against him?
Well, his demeanor's unflappable, and they're hoping that he can be a little off with his sinker. His sinker sets up the unhittable changeup. For Kyle Hendricks, he's going to have to survive the first inning. And if he can survive the first inning and have touch on his pitches, the Dodgers are going to have trouble. I think the Dodgers have to be aggressive and take care of his sinker. He throws a lot of strikes. If they get to that swing and miss changeup, they're in trouble.
All right, well, the Cubs are one win away from the World Series. The only thing standing between them and history, at least tonight, is the game's most dominant pitcher. Glad you're with us. Going to be fun.
There are two ways to skin tonight. Let's see whose road gets there faster. This is a game, no wrongs, no right. Only a winner and a loser. You and I, oh, you and I, we're not that different. You and I, oh, you and I, you and I, we're not that different.
I last saw her 71 years ago, the Fall Classic. Oh, if these walls could talk. So many great memories. History passed down from generation to generation. The players who bared their souls and captured our hearts. There have also been some strange moments, and some that I'd rather forget. The last 71 years have been amazing, but I do miss her. Most of you are too young to remember 1945. Tonight, we try to create a new memory, one we can share forever together.
How much more will this series give us tonight back at Wrigley Field? On a 55-degree night, wind is blowing out to center and down to the field in Ken Rosenthal.
Joe, for the latest proof that the game is getting younger, check out tonight's lineups. Half of the starting position players, 5 Cubs, 3 Dodgers, are 24 or under. Both teams are using these lineups for the first time, and there are two surprises. For the Cubs, it's going to be Albert Almora over Jason Hayward in right field. This will be Almora's first start in nearly a month. And for the Dodgers, rookie Andrew Toles will be their fourth different leadoff hitter of the series. Chase Utley, 0-for-10, dropped to the number 8 spot. Now over to Tom Verducci.
Thanks, Ken. This game is about the power of Clayton Kershaw. literally. He has been attacking hitters with his fastball more in the postseason than he did in the regular season. There's a reason for that. A little more velocity, and it's been tougher to hit. In game number two, the Cubs went 1-for-16 against Kershaw's fastball. For the Cubs to get to the World Series, they're going to have to get to Clayton Kershaw's fastball. Joe.
Tom, thank you. Same to Ken. And off we go in game six. Kenny already told you, Andrew Tolles is in the leadoff spot for the Dodgers. He's been terrific this postseason, hitting .368 for L.A. Then it's Corey Seager, Justin Turner, Adrian Gonzalez cleans up, Josh Riddick, Jock Peterson, Yasmani Grandal, Chase Utley in that eighth spot, Clayton Kershaw pitching and batting ninth. 16-game winner Kyle Hendricks on the mound. The game's best ERA. He's got the ball in game six. Ground ball, base hit into right. And on a line, a rocket through the right side. And Tolles says, let's start this with a bang.
That's a great approach. And I talked about the teams have to be aggressive against strike throwers. And I also said for Kyle Hendricks, survive the first inning. The team on the road trying to jump on the start of the Chicago Cubs. And what a better way, first pitch fastball. Look, Kyle Hendricks has a different approach than Clayton Kershaw. He knows he's not going seven. So he's grinding out every little inning he can before he turns it over to the bullpen for the Cubs.
There are the numbers this postseason for the right-hander. He was 26 years old, went to Dartmouth. Here's a ground ball up the middle. A tag and out, double play. Mr. Baez.
Well, there's the aggressive pitch down. Baez got so much talent, so much agility. Got him either way.
A professional tagger he's become. And Dave Roberts is going to go out and talk, just to talk. But what a play. And John, because of the defensive alignment, it was about the only way Baez could turn two on that ball that was hit by Seager.
Yeah. Because the shift, Baez was going to be the man that turns it just in case it was hit to Bryant. But this ball's hit right up. The runner's got to try and avoid. He did his best job he could. But of course, Seager doesn't run really well, so it was an easy turn once he tagged.
Hendricks has thrown two pitches, and we've already got a memory. Base hit to right, double play ball to the right side. Turner. Ball one misses inside. Justin Turner is 4-for-17 in this LCS. 10 hits this postseason. He's a good one. Takes a strike.
Hendricks keeps showing the poise. I don't know what's going on underneath the hood. He could be nervous. You never know. You don't know if he's up 5-0 or down 5-0.
There's been a learning curve for his manager Joe Maddon to read him. He said when his head goes down, his chin hits his chest, it's not that he's defeated, it's that he's mad. He doesn't show it other than that. And now he is one strike away from getting out of this first inning. For coverage of this game in Spanish, please tune to Fox Deportes. Turner getting good swings.
Well, the wind in batting practice, guys were making this stadium look really small, by the way. It's not quite as much, but it's blowing out. So fly balls will carry. That's why the ground ball sinker of Hendricks is so important if he can establish that down in the zone.
2-2 pitch. Full count with Adrian Gonzalez on deck. Into right, Back is Almora. No score after a half in game six. One save in four postseason appearances in 2016. Joe Maddon, a different lineup. Dexter Fowler leads off. Chris Bryant, Anthony Rizzo. In the middle, it's Zobrist, Baez, who was not hitting this side the last time Kershaw faced him. Then Wilson Contreras, Addison Russell, Albert Almora Jr., Kyle Hendricks. Pitching and batting ninth. And here's Kershaw, what he's done this postseason. It's 2 months during the regular year with a herniated disc in his back. This is the man the Dodgers want on the mound tonight to try to force a game seven.
Now all eyes will be on velocity and command. He has extra day of rest. He's been really good on 3 days rest.
One ball, one strike
for Clayton Kershaw. The game plan is simple. Against most of the lineup, he will throw in to right-handers and then mix in that slider. He attacked with fastballs last game.
That's down the right field line, slicing into the corner. It's fair. It's a double. You can read the lips of Fowler. Watch him out of the box. I think he thought all along this ball was going to slice foul until just before he got to the bag. Didn't matter. It took a bounce and got out of play, and he's at second with nobody out.
Fowler attacks a lot of high fastballs. Might have thought that was one, but it was a high slider, and that benefited him for just being able to get it inside the line and start this game off the way you want for a leadoff hitter. When Fowler gets on base, the Cubs offense is awfully good.
Chris Bryant now, the number two hitter. Just to give you the numbers to what you said, John, five or more days of rest. Clayton Kershaw's numbers are not as good with four or less. The four or less days of rest, his ERA is under 2.5. With five or more, ERA just under 8. Bryant, good rip, one ball, one strike. And is there such a thing as being too rested, too pumped up if you're Clayton Kershaw?
Well, that coupled with, you know, you got to win to keep your team alive in the series. I think he's going to be very aggressive with the fastballs we've seen right now. He can early on get away with velocity and not location. Look for Kershaw if he survives the first couple innings to lock in more on location later. Right now his velocity's up, and he can beat the barrel of the bats of the Cubs. But this matchup right here, you cannot make a mistake up. He wants to go into Bryant. If he leaves it up with a fly ball, he could be looking at a home run.
Strike two. Bryant does not have a home run in this series. He has won this postseason, hit 39 during the regular year. Drove home 102. Is the likely MVP in the National League. The guy who hits behind him will get some votes as well. Anthony Rizzo.
See, I would think he's trying to bury a slider in after fastball in. And then after these at bats, which is Clayton Kershaw, I mentioned, he'll be thinking more 7-8 innings. His counterpart's only thinking 5 inning at a time. This is a guy that has to get through the lineup 3 times for the Dodgers to be successful tonight. Nonetheless, if he doesn't get a hit, he was set up for that pitch inside. He goes away, and the great plate coverage of Bryant, knowing he wanted to get the runner over to third, he gets the benefit of both a base hit and an RBI and a much needed lead for these fans and for the Cubs.
Cubs have already matched their hit total between two batters from what they did in game two when Kershaw went seven, allowed no runs on two hits. Looking for his first home hit is Rizzo. Got hot the last two games in LA.
Clayton Kershaw struggled with the command of his curveball. 8 of the 9 were called balls. I think he abandoned it, and this is a game where he's going to have to find out if he's got the touch to bring it back in play. The slider is a swing and miss pitch for him. Only 4 swings and misses in game two.
Inside corner, strike two. With that, Corey Seager goes even more up the middle. Here's that last pitch right on the black. Left side of the infield, for the most part wide open, but Rizzo with 2 strikes now. Gonna have to swing it, choked up on the back. Cubs are 47-13 between the regular season and the postseason when Fowler gets on to lead off a game. Get on to start games 1 and 5. Cubs won both of those. 2-2. Look at the defense for the Dodgers. Andrew Tolles is out in left with Jock Peterson in center and Josh Reddick in right. Around the infield, it's Turner, Seager, Utley, and Gonzalez, Grandal. Trying to guide Kershaw through this game. Defense has sprung a leak the last two games for the Dodgers with those 5 errors. 2-2. That's in the left center field. Tolles is there, but he drops it. Bryant will head to third. Rizzo into second. We'll see how they call it. An error, John, on Andrew Tolles.
Yeah, you can see. I think he just took his eyes off of it just for a half a second. This ball was carrying. He got to it, and then he's making the next move to where he wants to throw it. And unfortunately for the Dodgers, now they're in a big mess. The Cubs cannot take anything for granted against Clayton Kershaw. You must make him pay in these situations and put the ball in play and get the runs he gives you, because he will buckle down.
Right now, that's up to Zobrist. Still nobody out. Strike one. Kershaw's going to have to do some job to get around that. Zobrist only 2 RBIs this entire postseason.
Bryant will take off on anything hit on the ground unless it's back to Kershaw.
Good pitch down and in, strike two.
There's that tight slider. These are the moments in games like this you never want to look back and say we had him on the ropes, we had 2 or 3 runs. You cannot depend on the next guy knocking him in. Zobrist has got to put the ball in play.
Zobrist into right center field, going to get it. Peterson tagging, Bryant tagging Rizzo. 2-0 runner at third, one out.
So huge. If they make an error in the infield, it's one base. That was two bases and a much more difficult position for Kershaw to wiggle out. Now they have to play the infield in, try to keep it at two.
Against the red hot Javier Baez, who's 7-for-19 in this series.
Cannot throw him a first pitch fastball here, I wouldn't think. I think they're going to go inside with it.
Was trying to launch on the National League side. Baez leads the way in hits this postseason. He has 13. Josh Donaldson of the Blue Jays, the only player with more, 15. The team knocked out by Cleveland. Indians await the winner of this series. World Series starts Tuesday in Ohio. The 0-1. Two strikes and Kershaw looking for the strikeout.
This is where Baez has gotten better in time. He gets two big swings and then usually with two strikes the big swing doesn't show up as much. High fastball, enticing to try to hit a fly ball. Hitter always likes to attack it. The velocity beats him. Beats him to the barrel.
High heat from Kershaw to Baez. Dexter Fowler got it started with a double. Bryant a single into right for an RBI. Then the error on the ball hit by Rizzo. Second and third, nobody out. Sack fly by Zobrist. Rizzo at third, one out. 0-2 to Baez. Good block by Grandal.
See what Baez has learned to do with two strikes is eliminate the big leg kick. He gets his foot spread out. And his foot's down. That was a pitch he would aggressively swing at before. So good try by Kershaw. But it's hard to swing at that variety of a fastball way up and then the slider in the dirt.
Up and after it again. The Cubs were tight back in 2003 when they were up 3-1 on the Marlins. I don't sense that with this Chicago team and the youth guys like Baez. They look like they're enjoying every second of it.
I don't mean this in a negative way. They're just too young to even know anything other than that. They're excited to play the game.
1-2. Take it back to pregame. That was to In the Air Tonight by Phil Collins. A 39-year-old leading him in that drum run that song is so well known for. The count still 1-2.
It's awfully tough. He has not thrown a curveball. It would be tough to spin it right here, but that would be the pitch that might get him way out in front.
This will be the eighth pitch of this at bat for Javier Baez against Kershaw. Be on the infield and it's Gonzalez who's the one standing at the end. Seager on the ground. And Kershaw out of the way. Two out, big out. So Baez can't produce the run. Runner at third, two out now for Wilson Contreras.
The Cubs are trying to do something that only two teams were able to do during the regular season. And that's put up more than two runs on Clayton Kershaw. Think about this. Only twice he allowed more than two earned runs in the regular season. They've got two here in the first.
Cubs had been 8 for 9 scoring a runner from third with less than two out via an RBI in this NLCS. Baez can't get it done. It's the 24-year-old rookie they look for the hit from now. And Contreras takes a strike. This kid has instant energy and all he's done is hit. 7 for 17 this postseason. His biggest hit was the pinch hit two run single he hit in the ninth inning of game four of the division series. The 0-1 right side, it is out of play. Strike two. Southern League batting champion from a year ago. 6-year minor leaguer, was at one point unprotected in this Cubs system. Any team could have picked him. Cubs keep him and now he's catching game six of the NLCS.
See, he's been missing up with velocity and his slider's been up. The curveball gives that built-in change of speeds. He doesn't throw many changeups. He's been working on it this year, but he's been pretty much on attack mode in this series against the Cubs.
When Kershaw comes set, he's looking at fans behind the Cubs first base coach waving at him as Contreras grounds it foul outside first. Let's send you down to Tom Verducci. Tom,
first rule of baseball, keep your eye on the ball. Well, Andrew Tolles did not. Why? Look at the aggressive base running of Chris Bryant. He's actually past the base and you saw Tolles take his eye off the ball and catch Bryant. And the ball is dropped and the door was open for Chicago.
Shooting a free throw. 1-2 is high. 2-2.
Yeah, you can just see right now, as much as he's putting in to the four seam fastball, a lot of them up. Needs a reset button. Of course, the error did not help. Giving up one would have been a lot easier had the out been made, but Clayton's got to find a way to correct the command on his fastball.
Left side, Seager with a backhand. Good play, and the inning is over. But the Cubs strike first. Two runs, two hits, one error, one left. Behind Kyle Hendricks, lead game six, 2-0. CS on FS1, tonight's telecast is presented by T-Mobile One. And tonight's telecast is sponsored by T-Mobile One. Welcome to Unlimited Baseball. And by Taco Bell. Sometimes you've got to live Moss. Adrian Gonzalez leads off against Hendricks. And Gonzalez takes a strike. It's see the career slugging percentage at Wrigley Field. He has the third highest among active players. He loves hitting here. A one pitch out in front of a changeup. Strike two.
That's the key right there, getting the Dodgers to not recognize the change of speed. It is one of the best in the game, and he can throw it to left-handers and right-handers with two different reactions.
Gonzalez took Kyle Hendricks deep into left center field in his first at bat, second inning in game two, and it was the only run of the night. Kershaw took care of the rest, as did Kenley Jansen. That's down 2-2.
It's going to sound weird, but when you prepare to pitch against greatness like Clayton Kershaw, you never think you're going to get the lead early. You just think it's going to be a 0-0 game, and you lock in and you sit in there.
Here's one up the middle. Played him perfectly. Did Russell. One out.
You sit in the dugout, and when you get those two runs, you're like, oh my gosh, this is unbelievable. You know, this is mine now. Now the pressure really goes on to protecting that two runs. You have to focus one hitter at a time. It's the hardest thing to do when a team rewards you with runs against a great pitcher when everyone's expecting it's going to be a close game the entire night.
One out, nobody on for Reddick. Josh 3-for-8 in this LCS.
Most nervous I ever was at any game in the postseason was game 7 in Pittsburgh, where our team scored 3 in the first. And I went, oh my gosh, I got to protect this.
Right side, down on a knee. Baez can't make the play. And Reddick is on with one out here in the second. And it's an error on Javier Baez. Did everything right, even went down to block it, still couldn't make the play.
This ball had a lot of top spin. You see how high it goes. He doesn't anticipate it. He's got it there, and in the transfer, just pops out of his glove. Knock it down. If it even goes off his chest and goes straight down and not in his glove, he's got a better chance of picking it up that way.
So Baez commits the error. That's his second of this NLCS. We'll see if the Dodgers can take advantage of a Chicago miscue, as the Cubs did in the bottom of the first on the error by Tolles. Here's Joc Pederson. Strike one with fireworks going off in center field. And Pederson, that was a free strike. He got out of the batter's box. And I don't know what Ted Barrett's supposed to do about it. Fireworks just happened to be timed up perfectly to that pitch. Listen. Can't blame him for being thrown off. Here's the 0-1. Out in front of that changeup. Nothing in two.
Pederson, I'm sorry, Joe. Pederson has one of the biggest uppercut swings when he's trying to hit fly balls. The problem is you really got to get a ball up from Hendricks to be able to do that. Otherwise, you just beat it straight into the ground.
Nothing in two, the count. Time called at the plate. A check on the runner, Reddick. Dodgers are in search of their 19th pennant, and their first since 88. Down in the series, trailing tonight. Struck him out, two out.
You might be able to count on your hand how many times Hendricks does that in the year. He lives from the knees down. He gets most of his strikeouts out of the strike zone down. And this is perfectly executed. Four seamer up. And we talked about Pederson loving to try and lift. That pitch always looks better to a hitter up. No way to hit.
Here's Grandal. Strike one. Yasmani's had one big swing in this series, and that was the two run shot he hit off Jake Arrieta in game three. Made a 1-0 game, a 3-0 game, and the Dodgers were in charge. Good block by Contreras.
I just think offensively, if your approach to Hendricks is you're trying to pull the majority of his pitches, you're feeding into his hands. You've got to think about going the other way. By thinking about going the other way, you'll stay longer on the changeup, and the fastball's not 98. And everyone thinks they can get a sinker to pull and do damage.
And then he slips in an 89-90 mile an hour fastball right down the middle, and the count now is 1-2. Around the error by eliminating Reddick on the pickoff. Thirty pitches in the first inning, the most in a first inning since August of 2011 in Arizona, when he threw 31. Bottom three in the lineup for the Cubs, up 2-0. And Addison Russell, who has gotten red hot since this series gone from here to LA, back to here again in Chicago. A big rip and a foul straight back to the screen. The Cubs scoring two runs in the first, one earned, one unearned. Strike two.
Well, here's the first inning, and the kind of really what you were seeing out of Kershaw was a lot of this. You know he's amped up. You know he wants to provide that game that he can get his team to game seven, but the fastball up is uncharacteristic out of Kershaw.
Now he bounces one to Russell, 2-2.
He creates such a unique angle by that hesitation and kind of two leg drives. And the hitter sees the ball come on him, even though it's straight, it gets on him and it's pinpoint. Then he throws that curveball, which he hasn't been able in two games now to have a feel for any touch near the strike zone.
Driven into the corner and left. Tolles won't get there. Russell digging for two. Another leadoff double. Is Addison Russell.
I don't think this slider turned the corner. Watch the spin. See how it stayed over the middle. And right now the leg kick and mechanics of Russell is more in tune than it was earlier in this series. There's the slider grip. There's the break. But it stays over the middle of the plate. And so that pitch has got to turn the corner for Clayton Kershaw. Everything's firm. Everything's up. And the Cubs are up.
Albert Almora Jr. first start. Good pick by Turner. Low throw and out. Well played on both ends. One away. Almora wanted to get a jump on Kershaw. And Turner with a good backhand.
Well, the approach has worked for the Cubs. They've been aggressive. They've squared up some pitches. With the pitcher on deck, you definitely want your eighth hitter to be swinging away here. You don't care if he gets him over per se. You're asking him to get the hit and then let the pitcher bunt. Great pickup by Gonzalez at first.
Hendricks has two RBIs this postseason. No sign of a bunt, strike one. Let him swing, says Joe Maddon. Hendricks went 1-for-1 with a two-run single in that game two start in the division series against the Giants. 0-for-1 off Kershaw.
in game two.
I actually think the pitcher will help Kershaw here with the fastball. You saw there 94 and more located. Right now all the other hitters have got him amped up and he's not locating the fastball.
Hendricks with a good swing, but in the hole now, nothing at two.
You're struggling with, no matter what the game is, work on it with the pitcher. Hit it going, because he's less of a threat of hitting a mistake than a regular player. And you see him go to the curveball right there. Tremendous depth to it, but it's just missing out of the zone, and the Cubs hitters are laying off.
Two and two. Fastball command is not there here early for Clayton Kershaw. Dexter Fowler, who doubled and scored a run in the first inning, waits to hit next.
You've accomplished your goal by making him throw you six pitches. That being Hendricks, I mean.
Boy, he's getting a good swing. I mean, he stands up there like a threat. And during the regular season, had only eight hits. But he can handle the bat. The count stays full. A seven pitch at bat, and Kershaw gets his first strikeout.
Yeah, I don't think pitch count will be an issue for Clayton Kershaw. He could probably throw 140 if he need be. But right now they're making him work for everything. They're getting good looks at his fastball. His slider has not been crisp. Rick Cunningham, I'm sure each inning will have to try and find something that he's looking at to help him smooth out and be more of the Clayton Kershaw we're used to.
Fowler is now 19 for 48 lifetime against Kershaw. He's had more at bats against Kershaw than any other pitcher he's faced in the big leagues. He gets good swings against number 22, strike one.
He does, and he doesn't mind hitting the ball in a little bit. The pitch away, the curveball, the changeup would give Fowler a little bit more problems, but Clayton Kershaw really doesn't throw the changeup.
Late swing and a foul, strike two.
I used to tell my ex-teammate and Hall of Famer Greg Maddux, it's real tough pitching when you're 0-2 on everybody. And that's what he feel like with Clayton Kershaw. You know, he's 0-2 on you before you even start. It hasn't been the case tonight, but that's what makes him so tough. You can't afford to work the count and get deep. His slider curveball combination with two strikes, almost unhittable, average wise and stuff wise.
Base hit. Here comes Russell. Throw by Toles. Cut off. 3-0 Chicago, and Fowler's stuck. But Dexter Fowler's two for two.
And the Cubs take advantage of the leadoff double by Addison Russell. Two in the first, one in the second. 3-0 home team after two in game six. Kyle Hendricks heads back to work. Grandal, Utley, and Kershaw, bottom three in the lineup. Grandal was at the plate when Josh Reddick was picked off. We're in the top of the second, and that pickoff for Kyle was his eighth since the beginning of last year. That's tied for the most in the big leagues by a right-hander, Julio Teheran. One ball, one strike.
Well, you can tell he's got good feet. He's got good mechanics, and everything he does is quiet. Quiet personality, quiet mechanics, quietly building a resume.
Mixing his pitches up really well here over the first two plus innings, 2-2.
Well, the goal for Kyle Hendricks is when the ball comes out of his hand, make it look like a ball, end up a strike. That's the toughest thing for a hitter to recognize when he's throwing it.
That's off the end of the bat, out of play. I know it's heresy to do it, but he's your good friend and former teammate. You already brought up Greg Maddux.
Right.
The stuff, the action is similar. I mean, Maddux is a Hall of Famer, and looks like the heart rate is similar. They both looked like their heart rate was about 52 when they were in the tightest of spots.
Study the game, work off the hitters, reading what the hitters are trying to do, not trying to overpower the ball, not trying to do too much. More importantly, when they get in trouble, they actually go slower. See, what Kyle Hendricks has that the game is missing is the ability to trick hitters and pull back instead of throw harder and miss wildly in the strike zone. When he's on, it's fun to watch.
Another one out of play.
And like I said, in the regular season, guys go up there thinking, you know, what's the big deal? I'm gonna pull this ball in the gap. It's almost like a comfortable 0 for 4, comfortable 1 for 4. And if you don't take away one of his strengths, and you don't dedicate yourself to try and go in the other way, you're gonna fall right into his trap.
Number 8 hitter tonight for the Dodgers is Chase Utley. He's next. One away.
See, and that's what he does so great. When a left-handed hitter sees sinker away, movement, he'll throw a four-seamer, and that pitch is going to look like it's actually 4 miles an hour faster. That's it with a hard down in the middle of the plate. He can't catch up to it. So he's changing the eyes of the hitter by movement and pitch selection. That cutter he throws doesn't move much, but the hitter gets jammed because he's looking for the pitch to go the other way.
He started the season as the number 5 starter in this Cubs rotation for a team that went 103-58. Here's Utley, strike one. He's now the number 2 starter and behind Lester and in front of Arrieta. That's how well he pitched. Arrieta, the reigning Cy Young Award winner, and had a good season himself. He would get the ball in a game 7 if there is one tomorrow. 0-1. One ball, one strike.
Well, there's a lot of formulas to winning a championship, but you need your great players to be great. You need unexpected players to deliver. You need players like this to come and exceed expectation.
The opposite way, but hit right at Zobrist. 2 out in the Dodger third. Ken Rosenthal is with us, and Ken, Kyle Hendricks may have gone to Dartmouth, but this guy was all baseball, huh?
He was, Joe, and he actually attended Dartmouth because his goal was to play in the majors. I spoke to his college coach, Bob Whalen, and he told me that he asked Hendricks during his recruiting visit, how important is baseball to you? Hendricks looked him dead in the eye, very determined, and replied, it's the most important thing. Now, coming out of Capistrano Valley High School in Mission Viejo, California, Hendricks didn't have many options. His other big one was the University of San Diego, but he couldn't have started there as a freshman the way he did at Dartmouth.
two quick strikes on Kershaw, and it goes back to what you said. Fall in love with velocity, and you're going to miss a lot of guys who can pitch, and that's Hendricks.
Absolutely.
Cubs coming to the plate, up by three. Brought to you by DirecTV. If you call yourself a sports fan, you got to get DirecTV. Call 1-800-DIRECTV.
There's their set down in the middle of all that mayhem.
Across the street from Murphy's bleachers, Sheffield and Waveland Avenues come together. Bryant swinging from his heels. Fouls it back, strike one. 3-0 Cubs. Bottom up the third with Ted Barrett, well respected umpire behind the plate. Bill Welke at first. Eric Cooper at second base. Garrett Cederstrom is the crew chief. He's at third. Angel Hernandez is in left, and Alfonso Marquez is in right. With Paul Naur, who was on the field for the first two games of this series in New York, in the replay office. One ball, one strike. On Bryant, who has an RBI single and a run scored. Strike two.
Well, coming into this inning, Kershaw had thrown 46 pitches. Cubs had swung at 28 of them. And they only missed four times.
See if Kershaw can pull it together here in the third. Two and two.
I'm right here.
Right field and easy for Reddick. Go through the last five postseason games for Clayton Kershaw. They're not all starts. The ones with the asterisks are when the Dodgers faced elimination. They beat the Mets. That was last year in the division series. The Mets would win that series, then sweep the Cubs, lose to the Royals. And then this year, division series game one, beat Scherzer. Short rest through 110 pitches. Game four, facing elimination. A no decision, but a Dodger win. He got the save in game five and then lights out in game two of this NLCS. Strike one on Rizzo.
Well, like I said in the first inning, it's difficult to overcome a two base error, and that's what he was given in that first inning. Two runs. He wiggled away from preventing the third run from scoring, but leadoff guys on second base in games like this, a lot of pressure to put. I don't know how great you are on the mound.
Rizzo. Ball one.
You can just see that curveball is just not right where it wants to. In high school, he was taught to throw that curveball using hockey pucks. And to see that hockey puck in his hand in rotation, he really pulls down on that pitch, so he could start that pitch at the belt of Rizzo and probably get a strike call anytime he wants.
Two and one.
Never heard about that before with the hockey puck. Just trying to visualize that and what that would feel like in your hand, trying to flip it over and spin that hockey puck.
Island Park High School, Dallas area. Here's one into left center. Back is Peterson over his head into the ivy. Rizzo's got a double. Inning so far for the Cubs against Kershaw.
This is one area you can't get the ball by Rizzo, down with a fastball. If he can eliminate the other stuff, he can lock in on the fastball. They were beating him up early in the series, tying him up on his hands. That's a sweet stroke down, and the only thing that Kershaw could be grateful for is staying in the park.
Zobrist with a sack fly back in the first inning, and that was his first RBI of this LCS. Now Grandal out to talk with a runner at second about the signs.
So far, no strikes on curveballs. Seven thrown. So easily in game two. Great approach by the Cubs as a team. Real aggressive.
That is hit hard to center. Back is Peterson. Tagging is Rizzo, and he will make it to third with two outs. Baez, who left a runner at third with one out his first time as a runner at third, two out here in the third.
Baez is a moment or two away from catching up with the high fastball. Kershaw keeps throwing it up there, and you know he's grinding, trying to figure out a way how to get down, bend down through the pitch and get it to the spot he's looking at.
In Ken Rosenthal's notes that he shares with everyone, he talks about how Javier Baez idolized Manny Ramirez growing up, and then Baez got to learn from Manny Ramirez in the Cubs system. And Manny was a special assistant with Chicago. Ramirez says he has as much power as anybody in this organization. He's trying to show it there, and he comes up empty 0-2.
And that's the difference when you can get it into a hitter who wants to be extended. He loves the pitch out over the plate.
Runner at third, two out. Kershaw trying to keep it 3-0. Foul.
See, Cubs hitters, if you know you're facing Kershaw, you got to make a determination if you're going to sell out and go and pull your front side and anticipate the pitch in. But what makes him so great, Kershaw, is he can do. We haven't seen the other side of the plate yet. He's yet to command the other side of the plate. Bryant took that away from him in the first inning with a double down or a single down the right field line.
Pressure on Grandal as Kershaw's bounced a few over the first three innings with a runner at third here. Rizzo on his toes, ready to jump and run at a moment's notice. There's the pitching line for Kershaw. Different story tonight. Baez strikes out on a pitch in the dirt, and Grandal will tag him to end the inning. Second strikeout for Kershaw sends game number six into the fourth inning. Dodgers coming to bat, down by three. Or celebrate your favorite team with the latest postseason gear at MLBShop.com. packed in the bleachers. They are packed in the grandstands. This place is crawling with blue. A strike to Andrew Tolles, who leads it off.
I still can't get over this guy's story. I mean, he could work himself into a pretty nice career with this abbreviated stint he's had here with the Dodgers.
He's 6 out of 11 in this LCS. And he hits this one into right. But he's getting good swings, and a guy who started the season at single A and was out of the game for a while, Gabe Kapler, who worked at Fox for a time, now with the Dodgers in their front office. He saw Tolles play, said you got to sign him. Good recommendation. He's leading off for LA in game 6. He's had a good series. Batter will be the number 2 hitter, Corey Seager, who bounced into a double play. Hit it hard back in the first inning. Seager with no extra base hits over his last 7 games coming in. But he is a superstar. The age of 22, that misses outside, 2-0.
Yeah, Seager is, can't wait to watch him the rest of his career. What a talent.
Back to Hendricks, who so far is making it look easy, 2-0. Well, tomorrow, start your Sunday with Fox NFL Kickoff and America's number 1 pregame show. And 2 of the season's biggest stories square off. Sam Bradford and the Vikings take on Carson Wentz and the Eagles. Our other regional action coverage begins tomorrow at 11 Eastern on Fox. Crazy chain of events. Teddy Bridgewater gets hurt, tears up his knee. The Eagles, who are going to basically redshirt Carson Wentz, end up trading Sam Bradford to Minnesota to fill in. Bradford's been great. The defense has been fantastic for Mike Zimmer, one of the best head coaches now in the NFL. And Carson Wentz got off to a brilliant start for a team that looks really hard to beat in the NFC East, although they and the rest of the division looking up at the red hot Dallas Cowboys, who have won 5 straight against an opening weekend loss. Good game. Turner, strike 2.
Can I just tell you real quick, all these people here and their bucket list to see their team go to the World Series and win it. You know what's on my bucket list?
Yes, I do.
You calling the Lions Super Bowl someday. Can you hang in there?
Mr. Michigan, to my right.
I'll try.
Not up to me. 2 out, bases empty, 1 and 2 on Turner. Just jammed it. How about Hendricks? Guys pitching in game 6 of the NLCS, and looking at him, you'd never know it. 3-0 Chicago. Bottom of the 4th inning, Chicago coming to bat, leading game 6, 3-0, and it will be the 6-7-8 hitters, Contreras, Russell, Almora, against Kershaw, who's allowed 3 runs on 5 hits. You called it early, John. They are aggressive, going after what many times first pitch fastball. They're trying to hop on it.
Well, every hitter but one, he's throwing fastballs to, so the Cubs are going to have to take advantage of Kershaw. Now, the flip side, he makes a great pitch. It's a 1 pitch out.
That's down the line. Into the corner. Gone. Contreras. 4-0. We'll be right back. pitch swinging again. Strike one on Russell. How about Contreras?
I don't think he knows enough to get worried about anything. He knows Clayton Kershaw's great. Probably doesn't know him that well.
Right side for Adrian Gonzalez. One out.
I think it's going to be another slider that doesn't do the job, and see how it spins right there, right in the wheelhouse, down the line, a little bit further down the line in each right and left field corner. But if you hit it this firm, 107 miles an hour exit velocity. The Cubs can do no wrong right now.
Takes a strike.
Look, I'm going to say this, and everyone assumes that Kershaw is completely healthy, and he's not. He's done a remarkable job coming back from a bad back that took a long time of his, away from his season. And what happens every once in a while, you get back from something and you might create one small bad habit. And tonight looks like he's rushing just a little bit, doesn't stay back. That's why the slider's not turning. So you never know. Even though he's come back in the second half and pitched great, you never know what little habit creeps up at the wrong time. And I got to give him a lot of credit. You can't miss 2 months of the season and come back and do what he's done and be completely healthy. I'm sure he'll address it in the offseason, but the ability to stay back with his mechanics, his back and lower body is super, super important.
It goes beyond Kershaw. It goes to the Dodgers, what we've talked about. They were looking up in the division against a really good San Francisco Giants team. Dave Roberts, who to me is the manager of the year in the National League, kept this team focused. They ended up winning the division by 4. Passing San Francisco without Kershaw. It was remarkable. Almora checks on Seager. Good play. 2 out. Came back after falling behind to the Washington Nationals, beat them in 5. They had a 2-1 lead in this NLCS, now trailed 3-2 and 4-0 after the home run by Contreras tonight. This has been a great year for the Dodgers, and just a 4-run game as they try to force a game 7 tomorrow night. Hendricks, strike 1.
So just to give you an example, what the front shoulder for a pitcher is, it's like the gun barrel, it's the sight of a gun barrel. You have to be able to stay behind the rubber when you go to home plate. If you rush at all, that front shoulder starts leaking out. Your mechanics and location suffer.
Hendricks grounds to Turner. And the inning is over. An inning that started with a bang. His first postseason home run. Making Cub fans and front men and leading men happy at Wrigley. 4-0 Chicago through 4. Welcome back to the NLCS on FS1. Tonight's telecast is presented by T-Mobile One. Here's a ground ball up the middle. First pitch swing. Gonzalez one away. And again, they have Gonzalez played perfectly. That's where Russell was for his first at bat. And Adrian Gonzalez 0-for-2, and he's checked on him twice.
Well, the Cubs, widely known as one of the best defensive teams in baseball, and part of that not only goes to the credit of their athleticism in the position field in the field, is their pitchers throw the ball exactly where they want to, so they can position and be athletic and make these plays. It's not because someone's smart enough and they put him in spots and they get lucky. It's because the pitching staff has low exit velocity. They hit their spots, and by the way, they're really good in the field anyways.
How do you feel about talking about exit velocity? Is that something you were worried about in your Hall of Fame career?
Well, actually, that's the one thing you can control as a pitcher, right? I mean, that's how hard they hit the ball. You think you can control more, you can't strike everybody out. So of all the different statistics out there, there is one that you can measure that guys just don't square you up. And so the exit velocity off of Kyle Hendricks would be, I think, second best in baseball.
Here's a 1-1. Popped up on the infield. Rizzo wants it. Baez takes it. And that's Baez maybe doing a little bit too much. And all Rizzo can do is smile about it.
Yeah, usually that is the first baseman's pick. Rizzo making sure. Dodgers have been in this spot, and they've come back the second most times to the Rangers. 46 comeback victories. So they're not foreign to this, and they're not totally obviously out of the game. They have to create something, probably starting in the fifth inning, but any magic they can get going now. Joe Maddon is not going to let Kyle Hendricks get in any trouble, and he's going to manage this game like a game seven.
Now more than at any other point, we talked about it with him before the game. He said, if I get a lead and we have a chance to end it in game six, I'm going for the throat. And so he will empty it all out of that bullpen if he needs to. But right now, it's all Kyle Hendricks.
Yeah, the lead would have to be greater for me to see Kyle Hendricks go more than six innings. But he's doing exactly what you need to do. Survive the first, getting easy outs, not even a lot of hard contact.
1-1 pitch. 2-1. Kyle Hendricks is 25-0 when he gets three or more runs of support in his career. He's up 4-0 here in the fifth with two out, nobody on. Good swing by Peterson, but it's strike two. Going upstairs messed up Peterson in his earlier strikeout. Now he strikes him out down. Hendricks in total command, leading by four halfway through game six. He allows kids 14 and under to compete for the National Home Run Derby Championship at the 2017 All-Star Game. Sign up today to host a free competition in your local community at jrhrd.com. 4-0 Cubs with the top of the order, and Dexter Fowler a big part of the night tonight. 2-for-2 with a run scored and RBI. Leads it off. The 0-1. Strike two. The night for Hendricks so far, the pitcher for Chicago. Tonight is the Cubs' 103rd all-time postseason game. And Kyle Hendricks is the first to face the minimum through five innings. He allowed a leadoff hit. A double play ball followed. Reddick reached on an error in the second and he picked him off. That's on the outside corner, strike three. Fowler didn't agree. Strikeout for Kershaw.
Backdoor slider catches the outside part of the plate. Fowler will go in and see that was exactly where Ted Barrett had it. The first backdoor slider, everyone he's been trying to throw down and in. Some he spiked down in front of the plate, and some he's left up that have been hit pretty hard.
Number two hitter is Bryant. RBI single and a run scored in the first. There is a man in the seats tonight here at Wrigley Field who is with his uncle Frank. His name is Ned Colletti. There's Ned. I'm assuming Uncle Frank is to his right, our left. If you look at his time as the general manager of the Dodgers, his fingerprints are all over this team. There's a strike to Chris Bryant. We'll get to more with Colletti after Bryant does something here with one out, nobody on in the fifth. The 0-2. Do it now. Ken Rosenthal, give us more on Ned Colletti.
Well, the story was by Paul Sullivan today in the Chicago Tribune. And Ned Colletti, for all his years with the Dodgers, well, he grew up in Chicago and began his career with the Cubs. So, in 1945, his uncle Frank was 12. Colletti's father and two other uncles went to Game 5 of the World Series, but they told Frank he could not attend. They were going to wait all night for tickets, and they said, you can go next time. Well, Frank, like other members of his generation, has waited 71 years for the next time.
Well, there's Ned. He was the GM from 2006 to 2014, and he's responsible for Kershaw, Seager, Turner, Adrian Gonzalez, Jock Peterson, Yasiel Puig, and Baez. I mean, that is a big. Here's Bryant with a pitch in the dirt, 2-2. That's a big piece of what we are seeing out here in front of us from the LA Dodgers. There's, I think that's Uncle Frank behind him. I know it's not Uncle Frank to his left. If it is, I want to know what Uncle Frank's been eating and drinking since 1945. 1-2 the count. When we talk about Baez and his ability to cut down strikeouts, well, the Chicago Cubs over 1 year of span really dramatically cut down on strikeouts. Believe it or not, Bryant changed his swing path and approach to cut down on strikeouts this year and drive the ball even more than he has last year. And he has made a 1 year adjustment that just speaks to the volume of these young players. Not resting on what they did before or what they're capable of doing. He wants to get better. He dedicated that in spring training, and that bat path stays in the zone longer now, able to get to more pitches, and you see the results. Probably going to win an MVP this year.
Yeah, after being the rookie of the year last year.
2-2. Right at Seager. This year's rookie of the year, you would have to imagine. Two out. There is a lot of young talent in baseball, great athletes, and they just seem to be getting bigger and bigger. Seager looks like a tight end, and he can move around. He's got a wide frame. Who knows if he stays at shortstop? He wants to, but these guys are bigger than we've ever seen him come along.
Yeah, and I'll be honest, I'm tremendously blown away by his hands and the way that he fields for that size. Yes, he doesn't have a ton of speed on the base pass when he's hitting, but when you're hitting a bunch of doubles and home runs, who cares?
Here's Rizzo now, two out, nobody on. Kershaw trying to retire his sixth in a row after the home run by Contreras last inning.
And until the Cubs flipped the switch, you know, in this series offensively, I think a lot of people were worried. Here we go again with the Mets shutting them down in a 4-game sweep. They absolutely, with their stud pitching, shut down the Cubs lineup. But this is a different Cubs team, and it did take just a couple things to get going. Ironically, a bunt out of Zobrist, but now they're confident again, and I think that swagger's back, along with great starting pitching. It's been great starting pitching. They beat you up at the plate with the long ball, tremendous bullpen, and great defense.
And a smart, terrific manager in Joe Maddon. High fly. Into right. At the wall. Come on. 5-0 Chicago. Rizzo.
Thank you.
Rizzo's come back since the fifth inning of game four. A homer, two singles the rest of that night, a three RBI night. Two more hits in game five, two more tonight.
See, Kershaw creates a different angle with this fastball, and earlier in the series, Rizzo took him deep foul. This pitch has not fooled Rizzo at all. He stays on lefties just about as good as anybody, and again, another pitch down, and you see the follow through and exit velocity.
He basically one-handed that ball into the bleachers. And it's a five-run game, a one-ball, one-strike count on Zobrist.
Kershaw has backed off his slider and getting better results a little bit late, unfortunately. And that statistic right there, since Daniel Murphy, he's tough on lefties, he's tough on righties. Tonight, he's been tough on himself, making some pitches.
Back to the homer. Hits, two home runs. Rizzo goes deep. 5-0 Chicago. Tonight's aerial coverage brought to you by DirecTV. If you call yourself a sports fan, you got to get DirecTV. Call 1-800-DIRECTV. Bottom three in the lineup, that's Grandal, Utley, and then the pitcher spot. You want to know what Dave Roberts is thinking in the Dodgers dugout with regard to the situation and desperation. He's got his closer Kenley Jansen getting loose, saying that the Dodgers can't obviously afford to fall any further behind.
And if this were a different era, Kyle Hendricks would say, this is my game and no one else is pitching it. But unfortunately, this is not a different era. Kyle Hendricks, as great as he has been pitching, we'll see how long Matt stays with him.
Matt just missed the count 3-1. If he's going to continue to face the minimum, he'll keep Joe Maddon standing in the corner of that dugout.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not saying my philosophies are perfect, but I never make a decision that makes the other team happy, period. My offense isn't hitting the guy. Why chance it with somebody else? I know that's totally different. I get it. And the game and the bullpen is so much better than it ever was.
Still rolling. One away. Our T-Mobile One in-game box score for the Dodgers. The first pitch of the night was ripped into right for a base hit by Andrew Tolles, and since then it's been all Kyle Hendricks. He got a double play ball on the very next pitch, got around an error by Javier Baez in the second by picking off Reddick. He's faced the minimum through 5 1/3. Here's Utley. Strike one.
I don't know how much longer Chase Utley's going to play. He's one of the greatest players in our game for his position. They love him in that clubhouse, but he has really been struggling offensively.
0-11 in this series. Andre Ethier on deck. That's Kershaw's spot. Utley trying to get on to inject some drama for the Dodgers here in the sixth.
Typically with Utley, he always had, you could draw a line over the middle of the plate and anything in was his. And if you made a mistake, he crushed it.
You could get him out of way, but he was so good at covering the plate this year or this postseason. He's really not, and the pitchers have not gotten anything in his nitro zone to get going.
Hendricks behind on the count, gets a ground ball. Baez stays down on a 2-out.
Hendricks looks nervous, doesn't he?
Yeah. He looks like he's pitching a night game in May. Andre Ethier will be the hitter, and the night is over for Clayton Kershaw. He goes five. Five runs on seven hits, two home runs. Run in game one. Two for six this postseason, one for three in this LCS. All but one of the runs earned against Kershaw, who threw 93 pitches. 2-0.
Could stay healthy. He's still one of the better hitters. He's had some great approach, but the injury coming back and just not being able to play the outfield position consistently for the Dodgers coming off the bench.
Coming off a broken leg, and now the count 3-1. Worked his way back, got his swing back under control in early September. On deck is Andrew Tolles, who's had two good swings against Hendricks tonight. Strike throwing machine, full count.
Well, if he wants to have fun, he could throw a 3-2 changeup right here. He hasn't been with a 5-run lead, been attacking. He's been going after him with a fastball.
Good play, Bryant. The minimum for Hendricks through six. Game six. So far, all Chicago. Cubs rolling, leading 5-0. Dave Roberts, the manager of the Dodgers, trying to keep it right here. Kenley Jansen, who's been sensational, takes over for Kershaw. Baez backing out of there as he swings and fouls it. AT&T call to the bullpen. Here is Kenley Jansen. And there have been times where he has just looked unhittable.
Yeah, he after that incredible performance that he had to go in game five against the Nationals, been unhittable in this series.
He jams Baez. Ball comes up for Seager. Bad throw, but dug out by Gonzalez. One out. Our game summary is sponsored by Michelob Ultra. Kyle Hendricks is the story for Chicago, at least defensively. Clayton Kershaw is knocked out after five. Contreras and Rizzo have each gone deep in this game. Contreras coming up, and here's his home run in the fourth. Statcast powered by Amazon Web Services. Jammed a bit, floater into left. Tolles has it, two out. The batter will be Addison Russell. Tonight's telecast sponsored by AT&T, mobilizing your world. And by Budweiser, this Bud's for you. And I would imagine thousands of those being poured in Wrigleyville and inside Wrigley Field. Facility that opened in 1914. This place has been buzzing since 2 hours before the start of tonight's game. Addison Russell now. Strike one. If you're a right-handed hitter, you can't even attempt to swing at that because it starts in and cuts, and he rides it up. You got to have some kind of quick hands to be able to pull your hands in to hit this pitch. You know, the theme of this series was going to be the starters for the Cubs and the bullpen for the Dodgers. And unfortunately for the Dodgers, as great of a year they've had, I think if anything catches up to them, it's the fact that the bullpen had to continuously work in just about every game.
Kenley Jansen, you saw that stat, who was originally signed as a catcher, is pitching in the sixth inning for the first time since July of 2011, and there are the numbers to back it up.
Yeah, and see, even in game three of the NLDS, Jansen gave up 4 runs in a third of an inning. Game one of the NLCS. Well, I'll finish that the next inning, but nonetheless, they're hoping they can get zeros.
Well, Russell strikes out, and a perfect inning for Jansen, his first of the night. Seventh inning now, 5-0 Chicago. 1 hitter being spun by the right hander Kyle Hendricks, and the guy who got that hit is leading off the seventh inning, and he goes after the first pitch, pops it up, one out. The only hit, first pitch of the night, tolls just past the outstretched glove of Baez, and then the very next pitch, Baez tag and throw, two out. Javier Baez is cruising toward a possible MVP award in this NLCS when you add the offense with that tremendous defense. Here's Seager, who's 0 for 2. And right on cue, here's Hendricks, who's faced the minimum, and there's bullpen action for the Cubs with Travis Wood.
Yeah, I mean, Joe's not going to leave anything to chance, not let anything get going. But I'm telling you, the game plan for each team has been really good. I'm talking about offensively. The difference is Hendricks has been much better down in the zone than Kershaw. Both teams aggressive, both teams trying not to get deep in the count.
Dangerous pitch, and Seager fouls it back. Two and two.
Hendricks all year at home, like most of the Cubs starters, been unbelievable. He only gave up 14 earned runs at home all year.
And it's frankly why he was slotted in second by Joe Maddon. The Cubs had home field advantage as long as they were alive in the National League playoff picture. He wanted Hendricks at home. Strikeouts for Hendrick, and Hendricks is yet to walk a batter. He's had the count 3-1, 3-2, but he's made some of his best pitches. Look at that changeup grip with the full count.
Unhittable changeups. Only one so far in the postseason they've been able to get a hit.
Justin Turner, bases empty, two down. Struck it. A clinic.
And if this plays out, continues to hold the lead, and they win the game, they're going to have Hendricks at home again for the middle three. Probably game three here, set up for a game seven if it goes that far in the next series.
The Indians are waiting. Terry Francona, that fun team to watch.
glued to their TV sets watching this one. Game six. One ball, one strike.
That's the uniqueness of his changeup. We see the consistency going away from left-handers, and then he has a changeup that he throws that doesn't go into right-handers, actually cuts a little bit.
Popped up. Rizzo. Wow. Stay connected to the game they love with unlimited LTE data. Welcome to Unlimited Baseball. That's the scene outside Wrigley Field, and inside Wrigley Field, it's all Chicago as Kenley Jansen brings home strike one to Albert Almora Jr. Makes his first start of this series here in game six. Who have caught the cutter of Kenley Jansen say it's mind blowing. It comes in as a fastball, and the last couple of feet it jumps to the side.
It's late. It's like throwing a football. Mariano Rivera like.
Almora strikes out. One away in the seventh. Tonight's T-Mobile One in-game box score for the Cubs. Dexter Fowler, big night. Not as big as the guy coming up. Who's at the bottom of that list. 0 for 2, and there's not a person in the park who cares. Kyle Hendricks.
I'm Kyle Hendricks. I don't even swing. Take three pitches and go back and focus on what you're getting ready to do. Take a chance at jamming yourself or anything. I know it's been an incredible night. One hit.
So much for that.
Yeah.
In the minority in that category. Fans are, players are. I can just tell you the feeling here at Wrigley Field right now. We're in the seventh inning. It is electric. Tension is high for a five-run game. The buzz is loud. Strike two on Hendricks. The Dodgers in the eighth inning will have Gonzalez, Reddick, and Peterson. Shallow right, and Reddick has out number two. The most outspoken duo in sports talk is now on FS1.
Monday, we debate week 7 in the NFL and Dodgers Cubs.
Skip the innings of just sitting at home resting right now.
You better rest up for Monday. Undisputed 9:30 Eastern.
Dexter Fowler led off this game with a double, scored a run on a hit by Bryant, then delivered a two-out RBI hit in the second that made it 3-0. He's had a big night. He's now 9 for 26. Hitting 346 in this NLCS.
He said it, when he gets on base, the record is incredible. The ability to score is much improved. And him coming back this year, kind of in a weird way. Weren't going to re-sign him. Looked like he was going to Baltimore.
Baltimore, right?
That's right.
Those were the reports. It didn't happen. He signed a 1-year deal with the Cubs because he wanted to be a part of this. And now he'll cash in. I mean, you start thinking about some of these players and where they are in their careers. Kenley Jansen, the guy on the mound, is going to be a free agent at the end of this year. And they're like stocks that you follow through the month of October. There's another guy who's going to be a free agent, Aroldis Chapman. There's been some highs, been some lows for Chapman. A lot of highs for Jansen. One ball, two strikes on Fowler.
It'd be very interesting because you know there's some teams in desperate need, and there are rivals. The Giants are one of them.
Jansen has faced 5, struck out 2, retired all 5. Inning over. 3 strikeouts now for Jansen. Let's go to the 8th. 5-0 game.
There is no curse. 1945, some guy wants to bring his goat into Wrigley Field. This is back in the day where men wore suits, and this guy wanted to bring a goat in? You couldn't bring your pet cat in today, and we dress like pigs. Billy Goat Curse, no.
Well, the Cubs and their fans are tired of hearing about it. There's the great Billy Williams. Such a gentleman, a great Chicago Cub, and you start thinking about the Hall of Famers that played here at Wrigley Field who were never part of a World Series in a Cub uniform. Ernie Banks, who died last year. The great Ron Santo. Ryan Sandberg. Ferguson Jenkins. Saw Billy Williams. For every one of the Hall of Famers, there's somebody that Cub fans identified with, like a Jody Davis or Randy Hundley or Glenn Beckert or Sammy Sosa, somebody who brought joy to these Cub fans, but they never got to the World Series. And then people who have been calling Cub games, like the legendary Jack Brickhouse, who was around back then, but in the Marines in 1945, he missed it. But the late, great, the legend, Harry Carey. Count goes to 3-1 on Gonzalez with Aroldis Chapman getting loose in the Chicago bullpen. Another 3-ball count from Hendricks, and here's a fly ball into center. Dexter Fowler, one away. Let's go down to the field and check in with Tom Verducci.
Thanks, Joe. Well, the man who brought the GOAT to Game 4 of the 1945 World Series and said the Cubs would win no more was named Billy Sianis, a local tavern owner. Billy Sianis passed away on October 22, 1970. That's right, exactly 46 years to the date.
Here's one into right center.
Yet the Chicago Cubs are now 5 outs away from going back to the World Series. I'm sure Cubs fans wish that Billy Sianis continues to rest in peace, and they wish the same for the curse of the Billy Goat.
Well, a base hit by Josh Reddick ends an incredible string by Kyle Hendricks. The crowd, I think, wants to see Hendricks continue, but Joe Maddon will play with this no more as he'll go to his closer. And this place should come unglued for Kyle Hendricks. A masterpiece for the 26-year-old. Talk to an agent today at 800 State Farm. And by Taco Bell, sometimes you gotta live Moss. One on, one out, eighth inning. Aroldis Chapman into the game. First up, Jock Peterson, and he is lifted for Howie Kendrick. And how about a bite out of a 100 mile an hour pitch and a chilly night at Wrigley from Chapman. Strike one.
Yeah, you'll see a little different Chapman than you saw last game in a blowout win that he came in to pitch.
101, strike two.
Joe Maddon said that one was on me. He threw a long time. We scored a lot of runs. Got him up the pitch. He wasn't effective, but 103, 104, very possible tonight, miles per hour.
Hard hit, Baez. Out at second, out at first, a double play. Moves into the bottom of the eighth inning. Cubs leading it 5-0, three defensive outs away from going to the World Series for the first time since 1945, 71 years ago. Jansen just pouring strikes. Chris Bryant 0-1. Cubs three outs away from their 11th pennant in franchise history. Here's the 0-1. Strike two.
Well, Dave Roberts said his formula was Clayton Kershaw to Jansen. I don't think this is what he had in mind. Being down 5-0 with Jansen dominating, keeping at least a prayer for the Dodgers.
Bryant 1-for-3 tonight. Meanwhile, the Dodgers have sent the minimum to the plate through eight innings. It's the fourth time a team has faced the minimum through eight in a postseason game. The last time was Don Larson's perfect game for the Yankees in 1956. World Series game five against the Dodgers. Strike three on Bryant. 1-for-4 on the night. The batter will be Rizzo. Howie Kendrick stays in the game and left. That moves Tolles over to center. After Kendrick hit for Peterson and bounced into a double play against Chapman. We'll have Grandal, Utley, and a pinch hitter in the ninth. Left-handed power man at the plate for the Chicago Cubs, Anthony Rizzo. They lost a big presence in their lineup game four of the season. Kyle Schwarber went down. Underwent surgery, has worked his way back. And for more on Schwarber, let's go to Ken Rosenthal.
Well, Joe, inside Theo Epstein's box on closed circuit TV, Cubs executives are keeping one eye on Schwarber tonight. He's playing in the Arizona Fall League for the first time since April 7th. As you said, he's coming off major knee surgery, but much to the Cubs' surprise, doctors cleared him to hit on Monday.
Here's a shot into center. Tolles, a nice catch. Two out.
So the Cubs activated him from the 60-day DL today. He would be an option for them as a left-handed DH for World Series games under American League rules in Cleveland. So far tonight, 0-for-2, two ground outs to the right side. But Theo said his swing looks good. He's just out in front on off-speed stuff.
Well, that's something that hasn't been talked about except for his comeback, at least to health. But his comeback to a World Series roster, and for the Indians, they have the right-handers in their rotation. Kluber, Tomlin, Bauer, if he's able to pitch. That'd be a big addition.
Be a big addition, but I just, that would be a lot to ask for a young player with no timing and
and then throw him in the World Series. Woo. Good swing by Zilbrist, strike one.
That would be incredible, but I think that's a lot to ask. We'll see. We'll see if that's a possibility.
Well, it's only relevant if the Cubs get to their first World Series in 71 years when they lost to Detroit in 7 games. That's out of play. The manager back then for Chicago, Charlie Grimm. The last Chicago Cub manager to be a world champion, the great Frank Chance in 1908. The Cubs won back-to-back 07-08 against Detroit. Their only 2 championships in franchise history. We're tired of hearing about 1908, 1945, and curses. This young team is bulldozing right through all that history, trying to do what the 2003 Cubs couldn't do. Up 3-1 and lost to the Florida Marlins, who beat the Yankees in that year's World Series.
Well, next man up has been the theme for the Cubs, and that next man up could be Arrieta.
Zilbrist spins on it and fouls it out of play. They've got Arrieta, who would get the ball if there is a game 7 tomorrow night. They would have John Lester on normal rest come game 1 of the World Series on Tuesday if they get there. Options unlimited for Joe Maddon. 1-2. Hard hit, and that's Turner to end the inning. And we'll stay right here. As game 6 goes into the 9th inning with Aroldis Chapman on the mound and a 5-0 Chicago lead. Let's go back to 1945, managed by Charlie Grimm, where the Cubs clinched the National League pennant on the next to last day of the regular season. Finished 98-56, 3 games ahead of the Cardinals, their 10th trip to the World Series. At the time, only the Yankees and Giants had been to more World Series. But now you look at these guys, Rizzo and Contreras and Bryant and Hendricks and Maddon, Chapman, Baez, trying to break that curse and guide the Cubs into the Fall Classic.
Well, they had to take this organization in a really dark place by not winning for a while to create the draft choices and the draft picks that they have now stockpiled and utilized, and Theo Epstein has not missed out. And they've hit on some lucky trades where you don't know what you're going to get. They're in position, and everybody will forget about a lot if they can get 3 more outs.
Well, there's been a defensive change behind Chapman. You saw Jason Hayward come into the game in right. Almora goes to left. Ben Zilbrist is out of the ballgame. Theo Epstein, the architect, with Jed Hoyer, the general manager. The University of Chicago product, Tom Ricketts. The deal was finalized October 27, 2009. Tom, the executive chairman. The plan, as John just talked about, was put in place. They said, just stick with us. We're putting something together. And rare is it, John, in professional sports when plans like that come together. And here they are with the most wins in the big leagues, with 103 during the regular season, 3 outs away from the 2016 World Series.
And the credit they got to be given is most teams build with power arms, but the Cubs went the other direction. Veteran arms, young, everyday players stay healthier that way, and you know what you're getting from your rotation, and that has proven to be a great blueprint so far.
Chapman will deal with Kike Hernandez first up. Hernandez pinch hitting for Grandal. Joe Maddon actually prefers right-handers to hit against Aroldis Chapman. On that arm side, all that room out there to do what he does. And that is light up a radar gun. Triple digits. Hernandez. Strike two.
Those pitchers climb the ladder. He climbs the radar gun. 100, 101. This one will probably be 102 to 103.
Just missed low for ball one.
He's got incredible gears.
For seven in this NLCS. Strike. Area down there that the Cub fans are tired of talking about as well.
Pitch right here must have been on the low side. Two things could have happened. Pitch down. Did he go?
It was below the strike zone. It was 103 and Ruiz checked his swing. Yasiel Puig will be the batter.
Shot. Out. Out.
These fans will never forget where they were on Saturday, October 22nd, 2016. As for the first time in 71 years, the Chicago Cubs have stamped their ticket to the World Series. And amidst all that mess, in the middle of this diamond at Wrigley Field, is Ken Rosenthal.
Thanks, Joe. Kyle, Cubs are going to the World Series for the first time in 71 years. What was it like for you pitching in this game?
Oh, man, obviously the biggest start of my life. I knew that going up against Kershaw again. We had such a good battle in game two. I didn't have all my good stuff, really. Today, that might have been the best game I pitched all year. I had my fastball command, changeup, curveball. Had everything going. Wilson behind the plate. We were on page all game long. But honestly, when you're facing a guy like that, those couple early runs we got were huge. You know, it allowed me to kind of attack more. But this is unbelievable right now.
The way you were throwing, when did you know you were on?
Pretty early. I mean, even after the first hitter, I felt good in the bullpen. I was just trying to keep it simple, simple thoughts, make good pitches at the end of the day. That's all I'm trying to do. Guys made the plays behind me and put up the runs. That's really all it is.
When you woke up this morning, what were your thoughts knowing the importance of this game, not just to the team, but to the city?
You know, I just looked at it as an opportunity. You know, this is what you set yourself up for. This is why you work all year long, is to be in these spots. Why would you shy away from that? You know, it's just like any other game. You know, the stakes are a lot higher, but at the end of the day, if you make good pitches, you're going to get guys out.
Kyle, congratulations. Thank you.
Thanks.
Over to Tom Verducci.
Nice moment right here, Joe Maddon and Anthony Rizzo. Anthony, for the first time in 71 years, the Cubs are going to the World Series. What does that mean for you and the city of Chicago?
This city deserves it so much. These fans have been amazing since the time I got here. And we lost 100 games of this. We have four more big ones to go, but we're going to enjoy this one. We're going to the World Series. I can't even let that sink in.
Take me to what your heart was beating like in the ninth inning. This ancient ballpark, 102 years old, everybody's standing. What was it like waiting for the last out?
Just enjoying it. We're up five. I'm looking at Javi like we always do. Every out, they got louder and louder. And you see all the flashes go on, everyone recording. It's amazing. These fans have been behind us, and we love them. Thank you.
Now, Anthony, there's been a lot of drama over 71 years, but Kyle Hendricks took a lot of the drama out tonight. What do you think of the way he threw the baseball tonight?
Kyle Hendricks is the professor. How about him? He just from the first pitch hit, and then basically he settled in, got the double play the second pitch, and seven and whatever it was, eight and a third. Amazing baseball. And we wouldn't be here without him and our whole pitching staff, so they've carried us a long way.
One more question for you. You caught the last out that sent the Cubs to the World Series. Do you still have it?
Do I still have it? I'm sleeping with this thing tonight. Are you kidding me? We're going to the World Series.
Anthony, congratulations. Back to you, Kenny.
Thanks, Tom. Here with Chris Bryant. Chris, you hear the crowd. What does it mean to you to bring such joy to so many?
It's unbelievable. I mean, these guys have been here with us every step of the way. They brought it today. It was really loud. I can't say enough about it. I don't even know what to say right now. I can't stop smiling. This is the coolest thing that I've ever been a part of.
What was the difference tonight against Kershaw?
We wanted it. I mean, we know he's the best pitcher in the game, but he's human. All of us are human. We went out there and battled. That first inning was huge for us. I mean, Javi making a huge play there to kind of, you know, get the momentum going our way, and then having great at-bats.
Now, you guys have played with the weight of history, and yet you've seemed unfazed by it. Why is that?
We're too young. I mean, we don't care about it. We don't look into it. It's a new team. It's a completely different, you know, time of our lives. And, I mean, we're really enjoying it, and with the work's just getting started.
Chris, go get in the picture.
I know,
back
right?
To Joe.
Kenny, thank you. Talked about Anthony Rizzo, Tom Verducci with him. Anthony Rizzo suffered a 101 loss season in 2012. And here's this organization, 4 years later, winning 103 in the regular season, beating the Giants, beating the Dodgers. And off they go to the World Series in Cleveland, Ohio. There have been 1,502 postseason games in Major League Baseball history. And John Smoltz, this is only the second time to face the minimum for a ball club in the history of the postseason. The other time, Don Larsen in his perfect game in Game 5 of the 1956 World Series. That's how good Kyle Hendricks was, Aroldis Chapman was. And the drama was taken out of this early as the Cubs put up 5 runs through the first 5 innings.
Yeah, exactly. Survived the first inning. That's what Hendricks did. He got rewarded with some runs. And Joe Maddon prepared this team for this journey. This is the one step closer to where they want to be. I don't believe they felt the weight of the city. And I think Joe Maddon is a big part of that. Embrace the target. Certainly the Cubs are talented. And now they can fill out the quest of their mission. And that's winning the World Series.
It's going to be some matchup in the World Series with the Cleveland Indians. You see the players, now the fans. Hearts pounding across the city. Take care of her. And you could see over at Murphy's bleachers, there were people applauding, cheering. Looked like one guy at the bar was crying. I'm sure this is an emotional moment with fans thinking of their father, their grandfather, their mother, their grandmother. Cub fans who didn't get a chance to see this over the last 71 years.
Well, much anticipated game. We thought we might see zeros being thrown up by the pitchers, and it was only one that threw up the zeros. Kyle Hendricks.
There's Murphy's outside. Across Sheffield. And the celebration is on in this city. This city knows how to have fun. This party will not stop until the early hours of Sunday, October 23rd. A dominant performance by the Chicago Cubs tonight in this series, this postseason, this season. And on to the World Series they go for a matchup with the Cleveland Indians. We are just getting started. A long night ahead on FS1 from Wrigley Field. Congratulations, Chicago. And Wrigley Field, where the Cubs have won it tonight, 5-0, and won this NLCS 4-2. It'll be a matchup of two hungry teams. The Indians have not won it all since 1948. The Cubs have not won it all since 1908. A long streak will be snapped starting on Tuesday night. Let's go down to the field. Kevin Burkhart, it's all yours.
Joe Buck, thank you very much. The Chicago Cubs are going to the World Series. And up now for the trophy presentations, I'd like to introduce members first of the Chicago Cubs front office with Tom Ricketts, the chairman of the Cubs, Theo Epstein, president of baseball operations, Jed Hoyer, the general manager, executive VP, Joe Maddon, the manager, and Crane Kenny, the president of business operations. With me from Major League Baseball is Joe Torre, and he's here to present the Warren C. Giles National League Championship Trophy. Joe.
Well, Kevin, it's such an exciting night and a historic night. And I want to congratulate all these guys up here. Great job. I don't know what you do for a living, but you do it pretty good. But it's my pleasure and honor. What a great night for baseball, and I know a great night for the Chicago Cubs. I want to present you with the Warren C. Giles National League Championship Trophy, if I can lift it. Okay, Tom?
Thank you.
How does it feel to hold that, Tom?
Well, it's pretty special. I just want to thank our players for all the great performances throughout the playoffs and the whole season. I want to thank our great manager, Joe Maddon, for keeping these guys focused, playing hard. I want to shout out for Theo and Jed and everyone in the baseball organization for putting this great team together. I want to recognize Crane Kenny and everyone on the business side who has kept this machine rolling. But most importantly, I want to say thank you to the greatest fans in any sport in the world.
Tom, you were walking around tonight. You were interacting with the fans, as you do a lot. This is special to you. You went to school here. You met your wife here. What does this mean to you emotionally?
Yeah, I can't really describe it right now. All I know is we got to win 4 more games.
Tom, congratulations.
Thank you.
Tom Ricketts. Let's bring in Theo Epstein here. This was a few years in the making. You've been here before. You felt this feeling before. What does this one feel like?
This is incredibly special. I want to thank all our scouting and player development people, everyone in the whole organization, from Tom and his family all the way down. It was a team effort. They hung in there through thick and thin. Our fans hung in there with us the whole time, the last 5 years. And it's extra special because it goes out to Billy Williams is here on the field, and Ernie Banks and Ron Santo and the guys from 69 who could have got there, should have got there, and almost did. And then the 84 teams, Ryan Sandberg is here, and Rick Sutcliffe and those guys. This is for all you guys, too.
Theo, when you took this job, what did you think of? Did you think this was possible?
Yeah. I mean, what prevents us from winning? And now all we got to do is win 4 or more. So when you got this kind of support from the fans, unbelievable players, the young guys, the veterans, they're all here for the same reason. Joe and his coaching staff, incredible leadership. Jed, Jason, the guys in the front office, all the ingredients are here. Now we just got to go do it, and that's our plan.
Can you talk a little bit about the guy to your left and Joe Maddon?
Oh.
And what is the most incredible thing he's brought to the table for your organization?
Unbelievable job by Joe ever since he got here. Changed the culture at the major league level. We loved everything that was bubbling up in the organization from the minor leagues, but to finish it off at the big league level, Joe is the best in the business, getting guys to relax, be themselves, focus. We embraced the target this year. His leadership's been everything, allowed our young guys to settle in and play as well as we did tonight. You saw how well we played tonight. That happens when guys can be themselves and embrace the moment, and that starts with Joe up top and his coaching staff.
One last one, Theo, before we get to Joe. I know you got 4 more that you got to win, but to this point, what's been the most gratifying thing about this club this year?
I just think how everyone's in it together, you know, from John Lackey and the free agents who wanted to be here for this moment and to get to the World Series and 4 more wins, to the young guys who, from the moment they were drafted as Cubs, had this on their minds to win it for these fans. The fact that we were all together and through the tough times, there was no one blaming anyone else. No, and now in the good times, no one's grabbing the credit. It's a complete team effort from top to bottom of the organization, all for one. Now we just got 4 more and do it for everyone here.
Congratulations, Theo.
Thanks a lot.
Theo Epstein. Well, Joe Maddon, just another Saturday at the ballpark.
My first thought is, we did not suck. First of all, before I get to the guys up here, where's our guys? Where's our players? How about a tremendous round of applause for these folks out here? And the other part of it is, because I've been there, our coaching staff deserves so much credit for what you saw tonight. Round of applause for our coaching staff. And of course, without the gentlemen up here, Mr. Ricketts, Theo, Jed, Crane, I would not have this opportunity to be here tonight. To be with you on a nightly basis is phenomenal. I know this is a playoff game, but you folks are like this every night, and we totally appreciate it.
Joe, when you had your morning coffee, yeah, what was going through your head this morning?
I wanted to watch football tomorrow. Where's Jay? My wife, Jay. Me and Jay got a better. Two teams are playing against each other tomorrow, so we're just going to sit down tomorrow and be able to watch a football game on a Sunday. That's the truth.
Well, you can do that. That's the good news. Before we get to the MVP presentation, one last one. If you could talk about tonight's game specifically. I mean, you've got a tremendous pitcher going on the other side. You guys came out so aggressive, yeah, so focused. It seems so relaxed.
Well, the thing I preached from opening day in spring training is I want us to play the same game regardless of the date on the calendar. I mean, everybody looks at me, the psychobabble component of that, but it's true. You should not change what you're doing regardless of the time of the year. Want to come out in the middle of October and play the same game we've been playing all summer. That's one of our best games we've played in a while regarding being clean with the pitching, the at-bats, in these circumstances, trying to do this for everybody, for you folks here. Listen, it was a spectacular evening. Thank you for your support. The boys have been talking. Four more, we could really have a party.
Joe Maddon. Okay, time now for the most valuable player presentation. Joe Torre, we have a special presentation this time around.
Well, Kevin, there were so many heroes in this championship series, but they have it whittled down to two. Javi Baez. And also John Lester.
Javi, let's start with you. This has been some ride in the postseason for you. You have performed incredibly. And now what does it feel like tonight to stand up here and hold that trophy?
Amazing. Amazing. Thank you guys. Really excited, man. Really excited to be here, to be winning, and to win four more games, man. We're ready.
You guys played with such confidence all season and especially all postseason. Even when you were down, when you had some bad games, you rebounded so well. What was the key to that?
Just having fun, you know, living my dream, playing like a little kid, moving everywhere and catching the ball, making plays.
How does this sound to you? The Chicago Cubs are going to the World Series.
Believe it.
Let's bring in John Lester. John, congratulations to you. Outstanding pitching, especially in this series. You've done this before with another team that hadn't won in a long time. What makes this city, this team, so special?
Listen to him. I mean, this is... outside before the game was crazy. Inside the game was crazy. I mean, these guys have done nothing but support us from day one, and it's been unbelievable to play here and be a part of this. Words can't really describe where I'm at right now.
Let me ask you tonight, you did a great job last night or in game five tonight watching Kyle spin his magic. What was it like for you to watch that?
Nerve-wracking. It's easier to pitch than it is to sit in the dugout, in the clubhouse, wherever, you know. Obviously, our guys did a great job. Kyle pitched an unbelievable game again. I mean, it's unbelievable. I mean, we get two runs in the first, and you know, obviously against a guy like Kershaw, you feel like you scored 10. You know, like it's huge. And now we got Kyle shoving into the eighth, and we got Chap throwing 100 and whatever at the end. So. Unbelievable feeling. We got another step to go. This isn't it. So we got to keep going. We got to keep grinding.
One last one. So you did it in Boston, John. How about one more time in Chicago?
Why not?
John Lester, he and Javi Baez, co-MVP. Why don't we talk to a few more Cubs while we're at it, as this team is headed back to the World Series. Chris Bryant is here. Chris, how you doing?
Good.
So your second year in the big leagues, it's been a pretty good ride so far, huh?
Yeah, man. I'm I'm so spoiled. I mean, this is an unbelievable feeling. I mean, these fans are unbelievable, man. This is the coolest feeling of my life. I mean, this is unbelievable, but we're not done. We don't want this one. We want a different trophy. Yeah. We all know what that one is.
So when the crowd chants MVP, does that give you chills?
Every time. I mean, this is, you know, you never play for those awards. I mean, but for these people to, you know, chant that, it's unbelievable. But this was an unbelievable win for the city, the team, the fans, and we're just unbelievable happy.
What does it mean for you to know that you've bringing all these fans so much joy here tonight?
That's all we could ever ask for. I mean, baseball is a sport to kind of get you away from your problems, and this is the best feeling in the world. And, you know, these people here, these fans certainly deserve it way more than us. They've been waiting for a long time, but we're certainly not done.
Chris Bryan. Addison Russell will join us now. I'll tell you what, if you watch the Cubs this year, besides obviously overall you guys being such a good team, you showed resiliency and none more so in this round. After getting shut out back-to-back games, you came back and the offense kind of went crazy after that. Take me through the mindset after game three.
You know, just trying to get back to what we do best, you know, and that's just working the count. And you saw it there. I think game four, you know, and we just got back to Cubby baseball, and we got the motors going, and now it's history, so we're excited to do it in this city.
It really is history. Cubs haven't been to the World Series in a long time.
Yeah, man, and we're happy to do it here. We're happy to do it here. All the fans stayed here. You know, we have to give back to our fans, and they've been tremendous all year. Through the ups and downs, they were here, and that's so exciting. I've never been a part of anything like that, And it's just tremendous to be a part of.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Addison Russell, as we continue. Let's bring in some more Cubs. Ben Zobrist is making his way. David Ross is making his way. Ben, you've been to this stage before. In fact, you were just there last year. What makes this so special?
You know what? We're in the best stadium in all of the world right now. Wrigley Field. I mean, I love this stadium. I love baseball history. And this, man, this is incredible opportunity that I got to get a chance to be a part of this with this club, this organization. Boy, I couldn't be more blessed right now.
Well, now you get a chance to go make history. Congratulations, Ben.
Thank you, thank you.
Let's get one more. David Ross.
That's unbelievable. Thank you guys so much. I love you to death. Thank you so much.
You have played a lot of baseball. You have won a lot of games. But this has been unlike anything else. This city loves you.
This city's amazing. This city's treated me with so much respect. These guys, it's a credit to my teammates. They've said tons of nice things about me and treat me with a lot of respect and a lot that I don't know that I deserve. And these guys have given me standing ovations and sing along with my walkout song and all the cool stuff that is being a Major League Baseball player. And I'm very, very blessed and fortunate to play in front of this group and to play on this team. I'm a very lucky individual, and thank you guys very much.
I've asked this before, but before we let you go, David Ross, how does it feel to say the Chicago Cubs are going to the World Series?
That sounds amazing. They deserve it. These guys worked their tails off. They better get used to it. I just told Tom he's got to build a trophy case, because you got a lot of young guys here. They're very talented. They play hard, a great organization, a great coaching staff. From the top down, this is a phenomenal group in a great city. Chicago!
And with that, we send it back upstairs to Joba.
Kevin, great job down there, my friend. Great job. And down goes David Ross, the 39-year-old, in his final season He's been a world champion before in 2013. He'll get a chance to go back to the World Series in 2016. You talk about the two MVPs. As you look at the reaction of David Ross. Over the rail he goes in his final season. What a way to go out. And now it's Javier Baez. October has been his coming out party.
I'm a man.
And he has been the man in the field with the bat.
I'm a man.
And then there's John Lester, who not only in the NLCS did he go 2-0, but 3-0 this postseason with a microscopic ERA of 0.86. They'll share the trophy. We'll continue on from Wrigley Field in Chicago, Illinois. We're here at Wrigley. The party is on. Cubs win it tonight 5-0, 4-2. And we'll send you out to the guys on the set out beyond the wall here at Wrigley. They're ready to go. Stay with us on FS1.